another edition of the Contractor's Secret Weapon weekly podcast with your hosts, Dave Negri. This program is dedicated to helping contractors, remodelers, painters, roofers, roof cleaners, and business owners in the construction industry gain an unfair advantage over the competition. This program supplies you with information that the competition doesn't even know exists. This session brought to you by ContractorsSecretWeapon.com.
Before we get into the conversation with you, I just want to do a shout out to our sponsors who help promote Contractor's Secret Weapon and just some of the things that they have in store for you, our listeners. Hey, is your phone ringing enough? Do you want it to ring more with highly motivated and qualified buyers that contact you, the contractor, directly? No more waiting for the phone to ring. Just answer that phone. Best Home Services leads are dedicated to making your phone ring with motivated buyers that call you directly. There's no obligation to talk with them. Just go to contractorsecretweapon.com/money. Fill out the form to secure your discount on the setup fee. Do it today. This special will not last forever. Check them out at contractorsecretweapon.com/money.
Running a small business is no easy task, and I should know because I had a service company for almost 10 years. I am the founder of a software called Radius Bomb, and it's unbelievable. And for all the listeners of Contractor Secret Weapon, we have a special offer for you to check out. If you want to send hyper-targeted, laser-focused, super-personalized postcards to your exact prospects using a map while sitting in your underwear, then go to contractorsecretweapon.com/radiusbomb, and we'll give you your first 100 postcards for free. Just go to contractorsecretweapon.com/radiusbomb.
Good.
All right. It did make a noise. Okay. So cool. I'll have to go back and do this. So, you know, I'm excited today, Hamid, because I know that you have some tremendous things to share with our audience on how to be the best leader that they can be, and because that's what you do. So I'm excited for you to be here. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Dave. It's my pleasure to be with you.
Yes, and I read your book, Your Journey to Fulfillment, a step-by-step guide to realizing your dream, which I thought was awesome. And like we talked about a few minutes ago, it's more than just a book because you've created it so that they can actually read it and then work through it on their own individual basis so that they can get through and come to their own realizations.
Absolutely. That's, you know, you summarize it so nicely, Dave. So would you like to talk about the book or?
I would like to talk about, actually, I think that your book is basically is about, you know, making your dreams come true. But what's your strong point is it that, but also helping you become the best leader that you can be? Because I think we need more leaders, don't you?
Absolutely. Well, you know, that's actually my mission, Dave. I'm going to blow you away. By sharing my vision. You know, I want to book breakthrough results when it comes to peace in Middle East by 2025.
Awesome.
And yeah, and I truly believe if we had peace between Israel and Palestine, there would be, 90%, 95% peace in the whole Middle East. And there is, there are many reasons for that. And if we have peace in Middle East, man, we have peace in the world. Yeah. Many problems start from the Middle East. And we have to, hit the root, hit the cause. And for that, we need leaders, and we need great leaders. And, the milestone which is going to bridge me to the leaders is my second book, First Class Leadership. And First Class Leadership is what I call the pillars of leadership. It's actually a house having three pillars.
Okay.
One of which is qualities. We're going to talk about qualities. What qualities are we talking about? The other pillar is principles, and the third one is attitudes. If you master these qualities, principles, and attitudes, you become a first-class leader. So what are those? All first-class leaders, or the greatest leaders on earth, whomever you call. For example, Martin Luther King, John F. Kennedy, Benjamin Franklin, Nelson Mandela, Mahatma Gandhi, Elon Musk, Steve Jobs, they all had a compelling vision. They knew where they were heading. They had a crystal clear idea about their final destination. And then they loved what they did. They were, you know, they had passion. You know what's why it's important to have passion, to love what you do, Dave?
Well, it makes everything meaningful, doesn't it?
Absolutely. You hit the core, Dave. You know, when you love what you do, you don't have to work. You know, you do what you enjoy. Nobody obliges you, forces you to do, you know, what you don't like. You do what you enjoy. And when you do what you enjoy, you do it well, Dave, you know. You do it with energy, you do it with commitment, with passion, and results are awesome. When you do...
Yeah, and anything about that, let me just jump in for a second. Anything about that, it's in every area of your life. I mean, it's not just business. It could be family. It could be leaving a legacy. It could be... it could be a number of things. So it's not just defined to just one area of things. It could be multiples, huh?
Absolutely, totally agree with you. You know, it's general. It's not, you know, dedicated to anything specifics. When you love what you do, you do it well. When you do it well, you become successful. When you become successful, you earn money. You know, you get paid for your passion.
I like that.
Yeah, and that's how Steve Jobs made it.
Yeah.
You know, so focus. Greatest leaders have had focus. They have been able to focus on one target only. You know, multitask is a myth, doesn't exist. You can't, you know, there is a Persian expression, I'm Persian, by the way, they say you can't hold two watermelons by one hand. If you can imagine, my father was a farmer, and he was pretty good in watermelons. We had watermelons up to 20 kilos, Dave. Can you hold two watermelons by one hand? You can't.
No,
I don't know
kilos,
anybody.
Yeah.
You know what the message of the, you know, this expression is? You can't get hold of two big things. You can't run, you know, many issues together. You can't manage many issues together. You can't achieve many goals, too many goals together. You have to make a choice. And what is the choice? You know, chasing the goal which matters most.
Right. I think it's kind of funny because, you know, as guys, and I know you're a guy and I'm a guy, and I know that we always talk about, you know, having ADD. And but I think it's or the shiny coin syndrome. We're always chasing the shiny coin. And I know that in my life, what I've had to do, because I have a tendency, I love this idea. How can I integrate it? And I finally got to the point through coaching that I have to stay on task. And if I come up with an idea, I write it down, and I have a folder that's called Garage.
Wow.
And I may never get to it. And that's okay, but it's there in case I ever do.
Right, yeah. Absolutely. You know, so focus, greatest leaders. If you want to be successful in whatever, you have to have focus. Mm. The next is you have to be decisive. You have to be able to make critical, fast, painful calls, which you have to make, necessary to make. You know, unpopular calls as a leader, you have to make them when they're necessary. You have to be communicative. You know, when you listen to Tony Robbins, for example, when you listen to, when we listen to John F. Kennedy, for example, do they say astonishing things, extraordinary things? No, Dave, they don't. But the way they say it, you know, creates fire in our bellies. Mm-hmm. You know, when you read through, for example, Tony Robbins' books or all other great guys who have made, you know, such an achievement, who have achieved, you know, who have come so far, when you go through their biography, when you read their books, actually many of them are just ordinary things, but the way they describe it, the way they explain it, the way they say it, that's, you know, what creates fire in our bellies. So communicative, it's got certain codes. You have to master those codes to be, you know, to connect with your audience. Courage, Dave. One thing, if I have to choose one thing above everything as a leader, as a successful businessman, that you have to have is courage.
Okay.
You have to.
What kind of courage? Because courage comes in, then you have that courage, what, to make decisions, stick by those decisions, whatever the case may be.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, courage, what is it? First, we said you have to find your why, your vision, your destiny, your destination, the reason of your existence. So you have to have the courage to follow the path to that final destination. Mm. Why do you exist? What is your message to the universe? What is your contribution to the universe? So having courage to push the red button, the right, you know, taking the right decision, which gets you closer to your final goal. That's what I mean. Right, courage right. doesn't mean being bold, doesn't mean being, you know, doing something to have done something. Courage means having the guts to make the painful, unpopular, costly decisions which you have to make to get you closer to your goal. That's what I mean.
Never give up.
Absolutely, never give up. You have to put skin in the game. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to be willing to take the hits and move for, you know, and keep moving forward. That's what I mean by courage. You have to do, you know, take steps nobody else dares to take. You have to set the goals, having the courage to set the goals, which are extraordinary, which require a lot of energy, a lot of passion to achieve. That's what I mean. And building highly effective teams, Dave, no matter how brilliant you are, if you remain on your own, you remain one beautiful person, you know, one brilliant person, but one person. You never can multiply your business.
Right.
So for that, you need great people around you. And that's what I mean, being able to build highly effective teams.
I know. My coach, one of his mantras, he says, if the guaranteed way to stay small is to never delegate or do it all yourself.
Well, there are different theories. And when many people think, Apple was made by Steve Jobs, but that's not true.
No.
You know, there were three of them, and without Steve Wozniak, Steve Jobs might never be able to create what he created finally, because Steve Wozniak was his right hand.
Right.
And he had the idea, but Steve Woz made those idea come to life. You know, it was a fantastic win-win cooperation. So sound strategy is the last quality you as a great leader have to master. So if you have to have a sound strategy, a great strategy, enduring strategy, which takes you to your final destination, your final goal. You remember Blockbuster? You remember BlackBerry? You remember Nokia?
Yeah, I remember the names.
Yeah, you remember the names. That's such a shame, you know,
it is.
That we only remember. Those guys ruled the mobile market. I mean, the mobile Nokia and BlackBerry, I think each had 45% or something market share.
Wow.
You know, the last figure I have about BlackBerry, they had 0.3, not even 1% market share, you
wow.
know?
Wow, that's crazy.
They lost out to bad strategies. You know, they lost out to digital revolution. They didn't come. They didn't see coming, you know?
Right.
And Kodak, the same applies to Kodak. They had their financial year, you know, best financial year ever before they you know, starting to sink. And so that's it's really important that you have a sound making a strategy. And in my book, First Class Leadership, I have explained what those mean and, you know, what steps in every quality has to be taken to get there. So the second pillar is you interrupt me, Dave, whenever you want or you want to ask a question.
Yeah.
Or yeah, absolutely. So the second one is principles, Dave. You know, we become successful by qualities, but we leave a legacy by principles. What are those? Leading by example. The best standard you can set for having your followers, you know, how to make them do what you want is being this the example. You do it first yourself. Integrity is, I call it, the ultimate currency. We become rich as a leader. Leaders become rich with integrity. They get bankrupt by lacking integrity.
Mm-hmm. I agree wholeheartedly.
Absolutely. And but actually, in my book, I say the first principle great leaders apply is reality check. Where do I stand? You use GPS, right?
Right. Or
when driving, you know? The first thing any GPS tells you, Dave, you're here. So where would you like to go? But it says first, you're here. Mm. So where would you like to go, you know, from here to where to?
That's a great analogy. Never heard
Absolutely.
Of it.
Yeah. You know, you have to know where you stand to be able to know how to get to where you want to be. And that's what great leaders do. They make an analysis of where am I in my journey?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have a 10-year goal, for example. You make an analysis of, okay, in which year am I? And how far of my journey, of my goal, have I achieved already? They do a reality check. It's like chess games. Have you ever played chess game?
I love chess. I think that it should be mandatory in every school because it just gives you that ability to reason.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, I have used this analogy to explain reality check. In chess game, you have to know what position you have and what position the other person has, you know? That determines your next move.
Yes.
Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, and humility. You know why? That's perhaps one of the most forgotten. I mean, in practice, many leaders say they're humble. You know why? Because it's nice to say you're humble.
Right. But being is another is
absolutely being is a mastery, man. It's you know, the key to humility is that you can grow when you stay humble and you raise your hand, Dave, I don't know, can you help? I have no clue what I have to do. Anybody who can help, you know, you can make progress. You can be ahead of emergencies. You can grow as a team, as an organization. And you can't know everything. That's period. Nobody knows everything.
Right, right. Yeah.
So that's actually
a great thing for leaders. I remember one time I was at a breakfast meeting, And I thought this was just, you know, talking about humility. We're having the governor, or the guy that was running for governor, came in, and there was like 50 of us, and he was just, and this happened to be in the same hotel, so he asked if he could stop in and just say a few words. We said, sure, what the heck, it'd be fun. So somebody asked him a question, you know, about business and to where it was going, and he says, you know, he says, honestly, he said, I don't have an answer for that. He says, but, he says, I can find it out for you. So he gave him their card, and he says, email me, and I'll get that answer for you. But I thought that was, you know, I had a lot of respect for the guy. He didn't try to just say, well, you know, he didn't try to not answer a question with another question. He just said, honestly, I really don't have the answer to that, but I'd be willing to find out for you. That's humility.
That's fantastic, Dave. And that's, you know, that's being true to yourself. Yeah. When you don't know, you just say, I don't know. Because you want to know, Dave. Because you want to know the answer. You want to move forward. You don't want to get stuck. That's, you know, that's the reason. Absolutely. And responsibility. Responsibility. One of the most important principles, Dave, is that you, as a leader, you take the responsibility to do the right thing for the right reason. Making the tough calls, that's the responsibility which is wired to your core values.
Yeah, and being responsible, I think, also falls under, you know, don't blame anybody else for the mistakes. Ultimately,
absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah, as ultimately as a leader, it's my fault. You know, if something doesn't happen the way I wanted it to, then I didn't communicate it properly. So
absolutely,
I'm going to take the responsibility. If I have a customer that's not satisfied, then ultimately it's my fault because there's something that broke down there. I'm not going to blame the customer for being a bad customer. That's crazy. But a lot
absolutely.
Of people do that.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, I call it, you know, just turn the TV on and watch how many leaders, presidents, you know, kings or prime ministers blame others, make up enemies for their shortcomings. And, you know, that's crazy. Don't take their responsibility to give their people what they deserve. So they choose for, you know, the easiest way. That's the enemy. They blame others.
Yeah.
Authenticity, Dave, is the next one. You have to stay true to yourself. You know, we can lie to others for years, but we never can lie to ourselves for 1 second. What I call the inner war eats us up from inside.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. You know why many leaders, many, you know, people recall that authenticity, that, you know, innocent authenticity that we all have been born with? They recall it at the later age when they're dying, when they're ill. You know, they confess things. They admit things. That's the result of that inner war. You know, you want to get divorced from what is not yours. That's what I call absolutely. So being true, staying true to yourself and your core values. So the latest pillar is, the third pillar is, our attitudes, and they're positive. You can't tell me great leaders, what I call first-class leader, just give me one who hasn't been positive, for example. They have been positive.
You can't.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's an impossibility. It's like, you know, I can't even come with a good reference. It's, you know, here's a funny one, and I'm sure you hear it all the time. Well, I'm not negative, but I'm a realist.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you know, it's very simple, but sadly, many people don't get it. When you're positive, you are well fueled. You have energy. When you have energy, you're willing to take action. And if you have had a coach, Dave, whatever you have achieved because you have taken action.
Right.
Absolutely. So
whenever I haven't achieved, it's because it's not because I haven't taken action. It's because I haven't had the right attitude to take the action. Because I knew, you know, listen, we've all gone through crazy things in our life, and you know, there was a time where back like in 2008, you know, one day you're a millionaire and the next day you're not because of the real estate thing.
So, that's right.
So you got all these things that are going through your head, and you just, I mean, I could still be there. I could and be negative about the whole thing, but you know, the attitude that I had was, I can't afford to be here.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
I need to move on because there are better things ahead than there are by looking back all the time.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, it's so important that you remain positive as a leader, because people look up to you, you know. And how are you going to break as a leader? Are you going to sit and do nothing? Are you going to give up as a leader? You know, positive leaders don't give up. They never give up.
No.
They, you know, they make up things. They set new strategies, and they say, I'm sure we're going to make it this time. And when you keep doing that long enough, often enough, you're going to make it.
Yeah, there's a solution to every problem. It's just, I have to find it.
Every problem has a solution. You just have to find it, you know. If it's not a problem, it's a fact, you know.
True.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the next one is proactivity. Proactivity is that you don't wait for success to knock on your door, but you create your path to become successful.
You
don't wait for others. You take action. You don't wait for future, but you create your own future. Yeah. That's proactivity.
I call it forward motion.
Fantastic, yeah. You know, an analogy I use very often is planting seeds. You know, you keep planting seeds. You keep planting seeds. And those are the things that are going to, you know, make you be ahead of others.
Right. And think about it from just the natural consequences of the way the earth works. If you don't plant seeds, you're never going to get a crop.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Fantastic. Yeah. Grateful, being grateful. And I take this actually from a very broad perspective. So grateful means being thankful, being grateful and for something or for someone, to someone, that you have achieved something, that you have achieved a level. So grateful has also, you know, to do with gratitude, that you give back, that you pay back,
right,
that you thank people, that you divide, that you share what you have achieved, that you share it with people who have helped you. You know, so that everybody grows. You as a leader, followers as well.
Yeah, agreed. That gratitude effect is just monumental in anybody's in anybody's life. And to think that it's not, that's because you haven't tried it. That's the only thing I can say.
Right.
Yeah. And the giving part too. You know, there's a natural part that's been built in us to give. And so if we can give, then that just makes us better human beings, but it sort of just opens up everything in our lives. And it's kind of funny because there's and a lot of people say, well, I'm not giving anything. But you know, there's this weird, and it's a law of reciprocity, and I'm sure you know it, that if you give, people feel obligated to give back. And it could be to you, or it could be just another thing in their life they're going to give to somebody else. So it's like almost that thing of like paying it forward, because it
absolutely
works.
Absolutely.
It's just one of those wild and crazy things that just are unexplainable.
Absolutely. The analogy which helps here understand is planting seeds. Mm-hmm. The more you plant, you know, the more you receive. And it was last month, Dave, I went to Iran and I didn't have any business plans, zero. but I was, you know, never before I was so grateful. Never before I gave so much to, you know, certain families, students, you know, I helped a few families. And Dave, I was surprised by the way the universe gave back to me. I got so many coaching programs signed, so many coaching contracts signed by board members of several companies. And I was so shocked. Oh, God, I didn't have any plan to give. I gave, never before I gave so much, and never before I got so much back.
It's amazing, and isn't it?
Absolutely. I was shocked. And I truly believe in gratitude. Absolutely.
Yes. I'm with you 100%. I see it all the time, and it's just fun to watch it happen. And it happens and you didn't even expect it. So it just totally blows you away.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, I say whatever you give, the universe takes a note of it, and that the universe is going to get back that to you, probably multiplied. That's how I see it.
That's awesome.
Absolutely. So purposefulness. The greatest leaders have had a purpose. An inner purpose connected to their inner voice. They have followed a reason to breathe, you know, to live, to continue, to get up, to wake up, to cheer up. And that's what I call having a purpose. When you don't have a purpose, it's kind of you're waving and it's kind of you don't belong anywhere, and you don't belong, you don't feel home at home anywhere, and you're kind of directionless, you don't know where to go.
Like floating in space.
Absolutely. And many people commit suicide because they don't have a purpose, they don't have a goal in their life, and it doesn't make sense for them to continue, so they give up. So greatest leaders have been also risk takers. I'm sure you know the story of Elon Musk, right?
Yeah.
He risked whatever he had to focus on Tesla.
Right.
And it paid back. And I know you have studied definitely the story of people like Steve Jobs, for example, or Warren Buffett or Bill Gates, you know. They have taken great risk to achieve great achievements.
Right. And even the guy with FedEx, I mean, he put up all that. It's like, it was, you know, when he started, it was not like, well, we're going to just try one area. He just like opened up, like went into $50 million debt to get this thing off the road and running so that it would work. Now that's risk. That's not just opening up, you know, one little city with, you know, and he just went for broke.
Absolutely. You know, I truly believe, Dave, those who have never achieved anything in their lives have never taken any spectacular risk.
Mm-hmm. They like to save.
Absolutely. There is a relationship between risk and reward. No risk, no reward.
Absolutely, for sure.
Absolutely. And greatest leaders have been solution-oriented, Dave. They don't come with problems. They come with solutions.
Yes.
They come with solutions for problems. You know, they don't seek problems. They seek solutions. They don't put fingers. You have done it. You failed. You did that. They say, okay, this is the situation we are in. What is the best we can do? What is the solution? They, you know, get people together to come to that solution.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And the last one is balanced. The greatest leaders are balanced.
I'm laughing because that's probably one of the hardest.
Well, that's one of the hardest.
Yeah.
And even people like Elon Musk, for example, it's challenging for them to have balance.
Yeah.
But balance for me, Dave, for many people, balance is dividing your time between work and and private matters. But for me, balance means doing things that matter most. At work is chasing goals that matter most. Mm-hmm. You know, that are connected to your why, your vision. And in private life, spending your time with people who matter most.
Right. So could you put it this way too? Because I've always thought of it, because I know everybody in business is like going, I'm going here, I want to do this, I want to be doing this, and I'm at work, but I'm also thinking about other things. For me, and this has just been for me, and it may work for other people, is that there's balance is one of those crazy things that, yeah, the word sounds great, but actually having it work is another great thing. And so for me, it was always been easier to be wherever I'm at is where I am 100%.
So fantastic. Like you said, very well said.
Going for your goals at work. If you're at work, don't think about being home. If you're at home, don't think about being at work. You know, enjoy the process in each area of your life, but be there 100%.
Absolutely. 100%. Absolutely. Totally agree, Dave. You know, it's the key to balance is scheduling. Mm-hmm. Even private meetings, schedule it in your calendar.
Yeah.
Spending time with your kids, schedule it in your calendar. If you do it often enough, it becomes a habit. You know, you don't ask yourself why you do that. You just do it.
Right.
It becomes a habit. So, and again, throughout my book, First Class Leadership, I come back to why so often. It has such a critical impact on our business and private life when we're clear what our why is. What is it we want to achieve in our lives? And when you do that, it's not easy, but it's possible. When you do that, when you have a clear understanding of your why, Dave, creating balance is simple math. Mm-hmm. You do things which you really love to do, which matter to you, either business or private one.
Right.
So, absolutely.
Yeah,
you know, why?
So much sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, that's the book and the end of the book ends by highly effective teams. So the title of the book is First Class Leadership, How Highly Effective Teams Can Achieve Breakthrough Results. And the last three chapters of the book are devoted to how to build that highly effective team.
Excellent.
You know, where to start, how to keep them happy, how to develop them, and how to make them stick. And there are things I have explained. Give them freedom, for example. Get out of their way.
Yeah.
When you have the right talent, just give them the issue, the target. And as long as they comply with company codes and with policy,
sure.
Get out of their way.
Yeah, they may be able to do, they'll probably do better than you ever thought they would be. So that's been exciting. This has been an exciting interview. This has been fun talking about this leadership stuff because, let's face it, we need more leaders.
Absolutely.
Not only in the workplace, but we need them in the home too.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And I think that we sometimes try to draw that line, you know, where we want to be the leader at work, but we don't want to be the leader at home. By default, if you're married, you're the leader. It's just
absolutely.
You can't. So take all of this stuff that Hamid just brought to us today and use that. And the outline is just awesome, and really get his book. So Hamid, how can our listeners get in touch with you, get a hold of you? And the nice part about the internet is it's not 7 hours away, huh?
That's right. Yeah. You know, I there is a website, first-class-leadership.com. So that's the website of my book. My contact details are there. You can the book you have got, Dave.
Yeah.
People can download it, so they can apply for leaving their email address, and the book is going to be sent automatically to them. Your Journey to Fulfillment.
That was an excellent book. Yes.
Absolutely. And the other part is, the other website is iMotionAcademy.com. So those are the things. I'm on social media.
Cool.
Yeah, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and most active on LinkedIn and Facebook.
Awesome. We'll put all those links on our show notes when it goes up, and we'll make sure that everyone has an opportunity to get that through the show notes page. But this has
fantastic.
Been a really awesome talk. I really enjoyed talking to you about leadership. It is one of my favorite subjects. Just being better, just all the time being challenged to be better.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dave, for your time. I really appreciate it, and I really enjoyed it talking with you.
Good. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Dave.
Again, I want to thank you for joining us and investing your time with us today. I hope you enjoyed this week's episode, and if you did, go to iTunes and give us a shout-out. You can also go to our website, www.contractorsecretweapon.com, and check out today's episode and leave us a comment in the bottom of the page. And if you haven't gotten your 15 secret weapon strategies to getting higher-end customers, get it while you're at the website. Also, I want to thank again our sponsors for keeping this podcast alive for your profit-making pleasure. And so go be profitable this week. Work smarter, not harder, and learn how to leverage your time and your knowledge so that you can be more profitable. Again, see you next week.
Thanks for joining us for another weekly episode of the Contractor's Secret Weapon Podcast with Dave Negri. We would love to hear your comments about this episode, so visit us online at www.contractorsecretweapon.com and let us hear your thoughts. If you are listening via iTunes, please leave us a positive review. The more positive reviews we receive, the more other contractors will benefit from this show. Thank you, and see you next time here on the Contractor's Secret Weapon Podcast.